This is the first video of our Q&A series, and we have received many questions. I'll try to answer as many as I can. The first question which I'm taking has been sent by Kali Prasad Rai from Noida, and the question is, what will be the genotypic ratio in F2 generation of a mono hybrid outcross? And the second part is, what do we mean by outcross? Now, whenever in genetics question nothing is mentioned, that means we are following the Mendelian cross. Plus, before that, we'll talk about outcross. Outcross term is normally used for mating between unrelated organisms or individuals. Unrelated means they're not having the same gene line or inheritance, but they have to be of the same species. So it is mating between unrelated organisms of the same species. So this is the outcross, what we call, and the organisms which we obtain or offsprings which we obtain by this outcross are called hybrids. Now, hybrids can be because of crossing between different gene pools of the same species or of different species also, but this is in the same species. And because nothing is mentioned in the question, so we are talking about a typical Mendelian monohybrid cross. So if we start with parent generation, Mendelian cross always starts with pure line. Say we talk about a trait for tallness. So pure line, that is homozygous dominant, is crossed with homozygous recessive. Pure tall and pure short. In F1, the gametes which are produced by this plant would be T, capital T, or dominant T containing, and here the gametes would be the recessive allele containing. In F1, if we plot the Punnett square, we are going to get T and T here, small t here. All four are going to be tall but heterozygous. So here, phenotype ratio is 4:0, all are tall. Genotype ratio is also 4:0 because all four are heterozygous tall. On selfing of these individuals, we will get F2 ratio. So if we cross these, that means heterozygous cross with heterozygous. The gametes produced will be dominant allele containing and recessive. Here also dominant and recessive. If we plot the Punnett square, here it's capital T and small t. Here also dominant and recessive. This is going to be homozygous tall. This is heterozygous. This will be heterozygous and this is going to be recessive. So, if we find out the phenotype ratio, that means how they look. This will look tall. This will also look tall. This will also look tall. But this would be a short plant. So phenotype ratio is going to be 3:1. If we find out the genotype, this is homozygous dominant as both the alleles are for dominant. So it is one. These two are heterozygous tall and this one is homozygous recessive. So genotype ratio is going to be 1, pure dominant, 2 heterozygous is to 2, and 1 recessive. So the question was about outcrossing. So outcross is basically from between two individuals which are not related. Not related means they do not have the same ancestry. And because nothing is mentioned about the cross, we take Mendelian cross. And F1, all are going to show the dominant character. In F2, the genotype ratio is going to be 1:2:1. The next question that I have has been asked by Divya from Tirupati, and the question is about something which is given in the NCERT book. What is written here is E. coli takes 20 minutes to divide, but in the book it is mentioned that 38 minutes are required to complete the process of DNA replication. How is that possible? So now let me write down what is given in the book and then we will see the corrected version. What is given in the book, if you don't have the recent edition, probably you have this misprint there. What they have written is E. coli division time, that is division time, is 20 minutes in optimum condition. So if nothing is mentioned, we always take optimum condition. So if there is one E. coli, that is the bacteria, and if all the conditions are optimum, it's going to divide in 20 minutes. That means one cell is going to give rise to two daughter cells. And the thing which is written is the time required for DNA replication is 38 minutes. Now this is technically wrong because first, DNA is going to replicate. Because normally it is nuclear division followed by cytoplasmic division. Here there is no nucleus because it is a prokaryotic cell. But the DNA is going to replicate. And then cytoplasmic content is going to divide. So DNA replication is mentioned as 38. There has been a correction which has been made in the book. This has been changed to 18 minutes. That means DNA replication takes place in 18 minutes and the complete cell gets divided into two daughter cells in 20 minutes. So those who do not have the new books, they need to make this correction in their book. The next question which I am taking has been asked by Satyaprakash Gautam from Delhi. And the question is, introduction of alien species into a new area poses a threat to extinction of indigenous species due to, and there are three options. The first option is that there is high nutrient requirement of these alien species, more intraspecific competition, and the third option is absence of their natural predators. So what exactly the question is? The question is, if there is an alien species introduced into an area, suppose this is an area where there are some indigenous varieties are here. Now, because these varieties belong to this particular area, over a period of time, they have undergone certain changes or adaptations. They are eaten up by certain organisms. They have certain pests, viruses, bacteria which infect them. But if a new species, a new variety, which is termed as the alien variety, is brought in. Now, it can be brought in purposefully or it can just come in accidentally. Like there are certain varieties which have been brought in purposefully, like Icornia, and a variety which has landed in India is accidental, that is Parthenia. So, when this new variety comes here, new variety, because it has just landed in the area, it is not having any natural predator, natural pest, which is going to infect it. So, the option C, that is absence of natural predators, is going to be the correct answer. Because the first two options, high nutrient requirement, anyways, they are going to compete with these indigenous varieties. So, they will absorb whatever nutrient they require. Second is intra-specific competition. They are the only varieties of their type. So between that species, there is no competition. This is just the individual member. There is no other plant belonging to the same species. So there is no competition. So the only reason that they can be threat for these is they don't have any natural predator. So if they don't have natural predator, they are going to multiply in huge number, and if their number increases, they are going to occupy the complete space, and now they will compete with these variety for space and nourishment. And that is why this new variety or alien variety is actually going to pose a threat to the indigenous variety. And finally, this indigenous variety may get extinct. The next question has been asked by Bhavna Kumari from Jharkhand. And the question is that glycogen gives red color with iodine and glycogen is stored in our muscles. So when we eat iodized salt, does it or is it responsible for the red color of the muscles? There are two parts of it. The iodine part, which we get through our salt. So iodine gets absorbed through or in our stomach and small intestine. So it gets absorbed here, it doesn't reach the muscle directly. When it gets absorbed and it is in the blood, then it gets concentrated. Complete iodine will be offloaded or concentrated in thyroid gland. And the reason why it is stored or concentrated in thyroid gland, because this iodine is going to help in production of the hormone that is thyroxine. And this iodine is required for synthesis of thyroxine hormone. So wherever a substance is required, the substance has to be sent to that area only. Iodine has no role in our muscles, and that is why it is not required in the muscle, so it is not going to be sent there. So this is one part which happens with iodine, which we take in along with salt, because iodine is required for formation of thyroxine. Now the other part, the color of muscle, the color of the muscle is red due to presence of a hemoglobin, basically, which is known as myoglobin. The hemoglobin in muscle is known as myoglobin, due to myoglobin. This myoglobin is nothing but hemoglobin, which is the red pigment found in our blood. Only thing is, when this is found in muscle, we start calling it myoglobin. So color responsible, a red color of muscle, is due to myoglobin. And the iodine which is coming into our body along with salt is actually required for thyroxine production, and it is directly sent to thyroid gland, and that is where it gets concentrated. It can get accumulated in certain other glands also, like gastric glands also accumulated it a little bit, mammary glands also accumulated, but maximum is in thyroid gland where exactly it is required. The next question which I'm taking has been asked by Soumya Naberia, but the place is not mentioned here. So the question is about secondary growth. How does secondary growth take place? Now actually this part, secondary growth part, is very long, but I'll try to explain it in short so that you understand the basic process. Now we are talking of secondary growth in dicot stem. Secondary growth in dicot stem. In roots also, there is secondary growth, but that is of a different type. This is the most important one. In stem, the outermost membrane is the epidermis. Then there is hypodermis. And in case of dicot stem, the hypodermis, this part, hypodermis, is colonchymatous. Colonchymatous means the sides or the edges are thick due to deposition of substances like pectin or cutin. So this is hypodermis. Below hypodermis is cortex. So this entire part is cortex, which is parenchymatous. So this part is of cortex, which is parenchymatous. It is made up of parenchyma. So all these cells here, they are parenchymatous, loosely arranged with intercellular spaces. Then there is endodermis. Inside endodermis is the innermost layer of cortex. So this is cortex. Inside endodermis, there are pericycle cells. And there are vascular bundles. So we are straight away drawing the vascular bundle. The inner part is filled with pith. So this is the basic anatomy of a typical dicot stem. In dicot stem, secondary growth takes place at two regions. One is in the vascular region and second is in the cortical region. Now what happens in the vascular region? These vascular bundles are open. This is cambium. Inner is xylem and outer is phloem. In between also, there are parenchymatous cells, but only thing is these parenchymatous cells, they get squeezed and that is why they look little elongated. And we start calling them medullary rays. This is also parenchyma. Now when secondary growth has to take place here, I'm going to make this separately. Suppose this is one vascular bundle, second, third, fourth and fifth. And this is the cambium strip that we are talking of. It is in the vascular bundle and this cambium is known as intrafascicular cambium. And now when secondary growth has to take place, these cells which are here in between, these cells, they also become meristematic. So, the cells of parenchymatous medullary rays, they also become meristematic. So as a result, what has happened is a cambium ring is formed. This cambium is known as interfascicular cambium. Now, when cambium is meristematic tissue, when cambium divides and produces new cells, it is going to produce phloem on the outer side and xylem on the inner side. Wherever the ring is, it is going to produce xylem and phloem. Now the first form phloem is primary. Later on the phloem will be termed as secondary phloem. This is primary xylem. Later on xylem which is going to be added here will be termed as secondary xylem. So now what is going to happen is this ring of cambium is going to divide and produce cells. It is going to produce phloem. So phloem is produced everywhere around the ring. Here also. So if phloem is produced here, what has happened to the primary phloem? It has been shifted even outwards. Same thing is going to happen here. So this is all secondary phloem and the primary has gone even out. So this is primary phloem. This newly formed is secondary phloem. Same thing is going to happen inside also. So inside it produces xylem, secondary xylem and it pushes the primary inwards. So here also there is going to be secondary xylem and the primary has been shifted inside. Same thing here. This is secondary xylem. Primary xylem will be shifted inside. The phloem is everywhere around the ring and the primary phloem has gone out. So now the sequence has changed. What was the sequence here? It was primary phloem, then cambium and then primary xylem. Here the sequence is primary phloem, that is this one, then secondary phloem. Then the cambium ring, then secondary xylem and the primary xylem has been shifted towards the inner side. That means there are two bands which have been added, secondary phloem and secondary xylem, and they have been added in rings. And when this ring gets added, then the diameter increases. So this secondary growth helps in increasing the girth of the plant. This is inside, that is in this region. This is also known as stellar secondary growth because the tissue which is inside endodermis is also known as stellae. So we can call it vascular secondary growth, or we can also call it stellar secondary growth. Now let us come to the secondary growth in the cortical region. The cortex cells are parenchymatous. These cells, they become meristematic. And we call this meristematic band as cork cambium. The reason why we are calling it cork cambium, because this is going to give rise to cork. So this is also known as phellogen. The reason why it is known as phellogen, because cork is known as phellum. So it is phellum generating layer. That's why phellogen. When this divides, it produces cork on the outer side. So now there is cork, that is phellum, which is added on the outer side, and new cells are added here. These cells will form the secondary cortex. So now there are two layers added. One is of cork and other one is of secondary cortex. So two layers here and two layers here. That means when rings are added in the structure, then the diameter or the girth of the stem is going to increase. So when we talk of secondary growth in dicot stem, there are two regions where this growth takes place. One vascular region and second in the cortical region. One more important thing which we have to remember here, that parenchymatous cells are differentiated cells. That means after cell division, they come out into G0 or G0 phase and they become specialized. This process is known as differentiation. These differentiated cells, if come back into the cell division stage, then we call it dedifferentiation. So the cork cambium which is formed, and this interfascicular cambium which is formed by dedifferentiation. So this is, in short, the secondary growth that takes place in dicot stem. I'm taking a question which has been asked by Abhilash from Rohini, New Delhi. And the question is, if high altitude birds become extinct or rare, which one of the following plant will deplete first or their number would go down? The four options which are mentioned here are pinus, second is oak, third rhododendron, and fourth option is conifers. Now, most of these plants which are mentioned here, they are pollinated by wind. So let us talk about this. And here the question is related to the birds. Now, pinus, it is a gymnosperm and it is wind pollinated. If you are able to recall, the pollen grains of pinus are winged and they have this exine extended in the form of two wings, which help them move when the wind is blowing. It is a gymnosperm and it is wind pollinated. That means pollen grains are taken by wind. Oak, here the male and female flowers are borne on the same plant but different branches, and again it is pollinated by wind. So this is also a wind pollinated plant. Basically, conifers, the plants which have this cone-like body due to acropetal arrangement of branches, that is this part. All conifers, they are again gymnosperms. So gymnosperms are invariably pollinated by wind. So this is also pollinated by wind. So this is wind pollinated. Now the only option left is rhododendron. Rhododendron is found in a little colder region at a slightly higher altitude, and there are two options here. Some scientists believe and say and claim rather that it is pollinated by bumblebees. And the other group of scientists say that it is pollinated by birds. So out of four options, the only plant which is showing pollination by birds is rhododendron. So here, pollination is by insects also, that is entomophily as well as ornithophily. So, pollinated by bumblebees and birds. And as we said, it grows at a slightly higher altitude. The birds which are found in that region, those are the birds which are helping in pollination. So if this bird, which is found at the higher altitude, becomes extinct, then out of these four, it is only going to be the rhododendron one which will be extinct first, or its number will get affected first. Other three plants or category of plants, they are 100% wind pollinated plants. The next question has been asked by Sushant Singh from Chandigarh. The question is, what is the difference, or what are the differences between sucrase and invertase? Differences between sucrase and invertase. Sucrase is a term given to all enzymes. That means here we are talking of a group of enzymes. So group of enzymes which hydrolyze sucrose into glucose and fructose. So here we are talking of a group of enzymes. So sucrase word is given to any such enzyme which can hydrolyze sucrose into glucose and fructose, or break down sucrose into glucose and fructose. Now, when we talk of invertase, invertase is a specific sucrase. So here we said sucrase is a group of enzymes which are capable of hydrolyzing sucrose into its components or its end product, that is glucose and fructose. Invertase is a sucrase. That means it is also helping in conversion of sucrose into glucose and fructose. And the mixture of these two together is known as inverted sugar. So the difference is, here when we are using the word sucrase, we are talking of a group of enzymes. And invertase is a sucrase. It is a specific sucrase. For commercial purposes, invertase is extracted from, for commercial purpose or use, invertase is extracted from yeast. Honeybees also produce invertase. Honeybees use this invertase, and this invertase is used to convert nectar into honey. So they secrete this invertase, which is used to convert this nectar which they collect from various plants and produce honey. Now, there are many technical terms also which are given to this invertase. One such technical term is fructosidase. So it is technically, or other, we can say alternative names. Alternate name is beta fructosidase. There are many names which are given to this invertase. And what we have to remember is that this is a group of enzymes doing the same job, that is hydrolysis of sucrose. And invertase is one of the enzymes of this group. So here we are talking of a specific name obtained from yeast for all commercial purposes. And honeybees also use it when they have to convert this nectar which is collected from the flowers to produce honey, which which is the reserve food material for them. This question has been asked by Ketan Upadhyay from Ahmedabad. And the question is, what is the difference between regulator or repressor? Actually, it should be regulator and repressor. What is the difference? So, and repressor. Regulator term, actually this question, though it is incomplete, but as I can understand from here, it is from the operon part where there are regulator genes and there are proteins which are produced. So, regulator term is actually given to a gene. So, this is a regulator gene which is responsible for formation of a repressor protein. Regulator gene forms repressor protein. That means the gene, regulator gene, by transcription and translation forms this protein. And this protein is known as repressor protein as it inhibits the activity. So this repressor actually is a term used for a protein. And it inhibits the activity of operator gene. We can take the example of lac operon to understand this. In lactose operon, if you are able to recall, there are multiple genes. This is promoter gene. And here it is written as I in NCERT book, but it can also be written as regulator gene, that is RG. And again, there are promoter genes, operator genes, and the enzymes here which are going to help in various enzyme synthesis. So, when RNA polymerase slides over this, this regulator gene, it undergoes transcription and translation to form a protein. And this protein is actually the repressor protein. And this repressor protein goes and binds at the operator gene. Promoter gene is the site where RNA polymerase is attached. So now what happens is, in this case, because of this protein being synthesized and the protein goes and binds with operator gene, it suppresses or inhibits the action of or working of operator gene. Imagine if a protein comes and binds here, then this RNA polymerase is not going to slide over these. These are the structural protein or structural genes. They would help in production of beta galactosidase, permease, and transacetylase. But if RNA polymerase cannot slide on this, these three genes are not transcribed and translated. That means here enzyme production will not take place. So, this protein is actually inhibiting the function of operator gene. So, two words, regulator term is given to a gene, which is a regulator gene, and it is responsible for formation of a protein. This protein inhibits the activity of operator gene, and that is why it is known as a repressor protein. This question has been asked by Muhammad Akib from Azamgarh, UP. And the question is, as we know, in PE, self-pollination occurs due to bisexuality, but Mendel performed cross-pollination with desired pollen grains. And how pollen-pistil compatibility or interaction occurs? One of the reasons why Mendel picked a pea plant, that it could be pollinated self as well as cross. That means it shows self-pollination as well as cross-pollination. This was one reason why Mendel selected pea plant. When cross-pollination was performed by Mendel in his experiments, the plants which he used were the same plants, that is pea plant. So, there is no problem in pollen-pistil interaction. Pollen-pistil interaction or compatibility issues come when the pollen grain of other species come and fall on the stigma. So in self-pollination, it was pollen and pistil of the same flower or same plant. But when he was performing all the experiments and he wanted to see how these two different types of phenotypes, they are inherited, and that is when this cross-pollination or cross-fertilization was performed. Cross-fertilization. But it was pollen of pea plant, one pea plant, and it was crossed with, or it was brought and dusted on the pistil of the other pea plant. So when the plant is the same, there is no issue of identification or incompatibility rather. So though it is cross-pollinated, cross-fertilization takes place, but there is no problem because it is taken from, or rather it was taken from the same plant, that means the plants of the same species. The next question which I am taking is, or has been asked by Animesh Dash from Odisha. And actually this question is a very good question. And the question is that we know that AUG is the start codon and it codes for methionine. So AUG is start codon and it codes for methionine. Does it mean that every polypeptide synthesized, methionine is going to be the first amino acid? Actually, when this transcription, translation, entire process takes place, this is the mRNA that we are talking of. If you are able to recall the structure of mRNA, suppose this is 5 prime and this is 3 prime. On 5 prime, there is cap. And this cap is of methylated guanine. And this is tail, which is polyadenine. Now, there are two codes which are here at the start. This is the start codon, that is AUG. And towards the third prime is going to be the stop codon. Any of the three stop codons, and here are the structural genes. So when this mRNA undergoes translation or translation, a polypeptide is synthesized. This polypeptide which is produced, though this process is not one step process, the first is going to be methionine. But after translation, this polypeptide undergoes some changes which are known as post-translational changes. Translation has taken place. After translation, there are certain changes. So what now happens is post-translational changes. And what all changes can take place after translation has taken place? That means this polypeptide is synthesized. Now, this polypeptide is the primary protein. So, post-translational changes would include folding. That means if secondary protein is to be synthesized, tertiary is to be synthesized, then it will undergo folding. And second, if this methionine is to be removed, so to cut of this methionine. That means after this complete process has taken place, that means even post-translational process, it is not necessary for every polypeptide which is formed to have methionine. But if we are talking about this primary one, the first form polypeptide, it is going to have this methionine. Because it is the start codon which gets translated, so methionine comes here. But if this polypeptide undergoes these changes, folding and cutting, then this methionine can be removed. So, Our answer is going to be in polypeptide, it is not necessary that methionine would be there. But we have to keep in mind that the first form polypeptide, which is the primary structure, would have this. After the changes which take place, then this methionine can be removed. So methionine can remain or it can be cut off. It depends on which type of protein is required. This question has been asked by Zoya Sheikh from Mumbai, and the question is, if a probe is made of radioactively labeled dsDNA, dsDNA is double-stranded DNA, dsDNA, that is, the probe is what is being talked about. So if the probe is made up of radioactively labeled dsDNA and is allowed to hybridize to its complementary DNA in a cloned cell followed by detection using autoradiography. This is a statement. Now there are four options which are given, and the question or the thing which is related to this is, which one of the following is considered wrong for the given statement? So given statement is about the radioactive labeled probe, and this radioactively labeled probe is actually a dsDNA that they are talking about. Now here we need to understand what is meant by hybridization and what is actually a probe. Actually a probe is a radio labeled single-stranded DNA. So it is a single strand of DNA which is radio labeled, and that is what is used for as a probe. And then when this probe is used for hybridization, suppose this is the DNA which we want to detect, and the probe that we are talking of is radio labeled and it is a single-stranded DNA, then this is going to hybridize here. So this is our probe. So this hybridization is when the single-stranded probe goes and binds with the complementary DNA. And for that, our probe has to be single-stranded. So out of all the options which are given, the first option is, it is double-stranded DNA. And they have asked in the question that which statement is wrong. The initial part was that the probe is radio labeled and it is a dsDNA. And then it is hybridized and then detected by autoradiography. The technical mistake here is that the probe is not double-stranded. Probe is always single-stranded. And when you use the single-stranded radio labeled probe to hybridize, it is going to go and bind with the complementary DNA. And that is how we are able to detect, because probe is designed by us, and say this probe has the sequence of nitrogen bases or nucleotides as AT, CG, AT. So this is what we are already aware of, we have labeled it. Now, if it goes and hybridizes here on the complementary strand, obviously A pairs with T, so on the strand, complementary strand, it should be T, here A, G, C, T and A. So if your probe goes and hybridizes with one strand, you automatically are able to detect the sequence of this DNA. So the first statement itself is wrong, that is, it is double-stranded DNA. Probes are not double-stranded. The other points are, it is radioactively labeled, doesn't make any sense, or it is not wrong. It is radio labeled. This probe can be used in autoradiography. It can be, because the radio labeled substances can be detected here. It is hybridized to complementary DNA or RNA. Double-stranded probe can never hybridize with anything. For hybridization, the complementary DNA should be single-stranded and the probe should also be single-stranded. So here the first statement that it is double-stranded DNA structure is wrong in respect to the upper part of the question which has been mentioned. This question has been asked by Amrit Kamboj from Amritsar. And the question is, why does lymph contain much less protein than blood plasma. Here we need to understand how lymph is formed. We know in our circulatory system, the arteries divide into arterioles, and these arterioles, they further divide into capillaries. So these are the capillaries, and these capillaries rejoin to form venules, and many such venules would join to form the vein. So this is artery, this is the vein, and here we are not talking about like every branching, so artery, arteriole, and the vein. And this is the set of capillaries. The wall of capillaries is made up of a single layer of flat cells, which we call squamous epithelium. Is of squamous epithelium. That means if this is the lumen of the capillary, the cells are flat and just one layer. So basically, it is just made up of thin membrane, which is made up of single layer of cells. Now, when the blood comes from the artery to arterioles, there is difference in the diameter. This is a wider pipe or tube, and this is a narrower one. So the blood which comes into the capillaries comes at higher pressure. A bigger diameter tube, when the liquid flows in that, and suddenly if the lumen becomes narrow, the pressure is going to increase. So at capillary, pressure is more, pressure is more, plus the wall is thin. Wall is thin. So this plasma, the blood plasma which is flowing through it, gets filtered. And what can filter out through this thin membrane are only small particles. So here what comes here is plasma, ions, which are smaller substances. Proteins are big molecules. They cannot cross the membrane. So here there are no proteins, as proteins are big molecules and cannot cross the membrane of the capillaries. And that is why all the protein remains in the blood, and only this plasma with some smaller molecules, it gets filtered. There are cells also found in lymph. So what is formed here is the lymph. And lymph contains lymphocytes, that is the WBCs, and they can squeeze out through the capillary wall by dipediasis. That is why those cells are there, but no proteins, as the wall is very thin and the protein molecules are big molecules. They cannot cross this membrane. And that is why all the protein remains in the plasma and nothing comes in the lymphatic part or in the lymph. And so lymph is without those proteins which are normally there in plasma. The next question has been asked by Kali Prasad Rai from Noida. And the question is that XXY condition in Drosophila leads to femaleness, whereas in human beings, the same condition leads to Klinefelter syndrome. What does it prove? So basically the condition is X, X and Y. In Drosophila, this leads to femaleness. Such individuals are female. Whereas the same condition in humans leads to a disorder which is known as Klinefelter's or Klinefelter's syndrome. Now the basic reason for this is, in Drosophila, Y chromosome does not contain the gene which decides maleness. Y chromosome has no gene for maleness. In case of Drosophila, the sex of the offspring is decided by a ratio. Sex is decided by ratio of X chromosomes to autosomes. And that is how the sex determination takes place. But in case of humans, that is in males, human males, the Y chromosome contains a gene, SRY gene, and this gene is responsible for testis formation. And that is why, in case of human beings, Y chromosome is responsible for sex determination, whereas in Drosophila, the ratio has changed. Ratio is of sex chromosome and autosome ratio. And that is what decides the sex of the organism. So in this question, there are four options which are given. The first option is the correct answer. In human beings, Y chromosome is active in sex determination. In Drosophila also there is Y chromosome, but it is not having the specific gene which decides maleness. Whereas in case of human males, there is a specific gene which is responsible for testis formation. There are other genes on Y chromosomes which help in androgen synthesis. All these things are related to male sex. So here in Drosophila, this condition, because X chromosome number has increased, results into femaleness. And in case of this condition, the individual is a male which shows feminine characters, which are the symptoms of this Klinefelter syndrome. So in humans, Y chromosome is responsible for sex determination, that is maleness. The next question which I'm taking has been asked by Lakshika Bhandari and the place is not mentioned. The question is, explain the mechanism of muscle contraction. Now, muscle contraction is a complicated process. There are two theories which are actually given. The most common is sliding filament theory. But before we talk of the mechanism of contraction, we need to understand the structure. If we draw a muscle fiber, then we are drawing a sarcomere here. There is this membrane which is called the Z line. So this is Z line and this is Z line. Attached to Z line are actin filaments on both the sides. An actin filament is a thin filament. So these are all actin filaments which are extended on one side as well as on the other side. Same thing is on this membrane also. So this is actin again on both the sides. And as it is thin, we are drawing it in the form of thin lines. In between is present myosin, which is a thick protein. This is the myosin protein and it is between these actin filaments. So this is the dark one, thick one, that is myosin. Now we will label these areas. The distance between two Z lines is known as the sarcomere. And sarcomere is the basic structural and contractile unit of the muscle. Structural and contractile unit of the muscle. The entire muscle is made up of the same kind of sarcomeres. And these are the two Z lines that we have drawn. There is an area where actin and myosin, they are overlapping each other. If we leave that area, that means we are taking the area where there is only myosin. This is known as H zone or H band. The area which is having complete myosin, that means this much part from this end to this end, is known as A band or dark band. A or dark band. That means the complete length of myosin. And the region where there is only actin present, that means this much part, is the I band. And the sarcomere is made up of one A band, half of I from this side and half of I from the other side. So this is basically the structure. Now, when we want to understand the mechanism of contraction, we need to know the detailed structure of actin and myosin also. So, actin filament is made up of actin monomers. So, if we draw these mono units, these are the monomers of actin, and there are two more proteins which are there. One protein which is coiled around it, it goes in the spiral manner around it. This spiral protein or the spiral thread-like structure which is wrapped around this, this is known as tropomyosin. And there are some proteins which are known as troponins. So this is troponin, here is troponin, so this one is troponin. And the red ones which we have drawn, these are actually the actin monomers. The place where troponin is attached is actually the active site. I'm going to represent the same structure in a slightly different manner also. Suppose this is our actin filament and these are the active sites. What is attached on the active site are troponins. So this is troponin. And the tropomyosin thread is wrapped around you like this. So this is what is the different representation of the actin filament. So there are actin monomers which form a thread-like structure. On this actin monomer, there are active sites. And on these active sites are attached the troponin molecules. So troponin is here and tropomyosin is wrapped around. Now let us talk about myosin filament. This was actin. Now we talk of myosin filament. Each myosin is actually is having a thread-like structure where there are two arms and there are two head-like structures. So these are known as myosin head. And many such heads and the myosin filaments have joined together to form this thread. So this myosin which we have drawn here, the thick filament, is actually made up of the heads and the tails here. The heads and tails on this side also. From here, head and tail, so heads have protruding out and all tails have combined to form a thick band. Now this is the structure which we have understood now. The theory of muscle contraction is sliding filament theory. Theory of muscle contraction is known as sliding filament theory. It was given by A.F. Huxley and H.E. Huxley. And that is why it is written as Huxley and Huxley's sliding filament theory. According to the sliding filament theory, these actin filaments are going to slide into the myosin threads. And because they are going to move inwards, that is why it is known as sliding filament theory. Now, we will draw the same structure to understand it in a slightly more detail. So let me draw it here. Let me erase this and let us draw this part. Say this is the myosin part which we are drawing, and these are the heads of myosin which are protruding out, and here is the actin filament. So this is actin, and these are the active sites of actin. What is attached on the active site is troponin. So active sites are right now blocked. Say this is the membrane of the muscle. When the muscle receives stimulus, the stimulus is going to come. This stimulus travels into the muscle through T tubules and Z lines. Now this impulse has gone here. There is this Z line here to which this actin is attached. And here are sarcoplasmic reticulum, the endoplasmic reticulum, which is found inside the muscle. As soon as the stimulus reaches it, permeability of this is ER, that is sarcoplasmic reticulum, increases and it releases calcium ions. As soon as calcium ions are released, troponin, which is attached to the active site, which has a very high affinity towards calcium, goes and binds with this calcium. So this troponin has moved from its active site where it was attached, and now it goes and attaches to calcium. That means now this active site is free and troponin is attached to calcium. As soon as this active site gets free, now what is going to happen? This is the free active site, and the head of myosin is going to attach here. The head attaches to the active site. So this is the part, the head is attached to it. Let me draw it like this. Say this is the head, myosin, and this is the head which is attached now. This head acts as ATPase, an enzyme, which is going to help in dissociation of ATP into ADP and inorganic phosphate. And the energy which is released from here is used for two things. The things where this energy is used are two. For example, if this is the active site of the actin, which is now free as troponin has gone with calcium. So the head of myosin binds here. This head is attached, and this connection is known as actin-myosin cross bridge. We call it cross bridge formation. So the energy which is released by hydrolysis of 1-ATP is actually used for two processes. One, the head binds here. This is cross bridge. And then the head of myosin gives a power stroke. Power stroke is like this. Energy finished, this cross bridge breaks and the head takes a recovery stroke. Now at this place, there is again one active site which is free because of calcium. Again, 1-ATP hydrolyzed, one cross bridge is formed. Again, a power stroke. So because of these power strokes, this actin is being pulled inwards. So the actin filaments are going to move like this. The actin filaments are actually sliding in. And that is why this theory is known as sliding filament theory. So actin has these active sites, which are normally occupied with troponin. Troponin is normally attached. Whenever muscle receives a stimulus, from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, calcium ions are released, and this troponin has a very high affinity towards calcium. So troponin goes and binds with calcium. Now this active site is free. Head of myosin binds here with expenditure of energy, which is coming by hydrolysis of 1-ATP. Some part of the energy gets used up for this cross bridge formation. The other half of energy is used to give a power stroke. So the head of myosin, this head, gives a power stroke like this. So energy finished. Now this cross bridge breaks. It takes a recovery stroke, comes to its normal position, again binds with another active site, again gives a power stroke, again energy finished, again comes here, recovery stroke, and so on. So the actin goes on sliding in and in and in. So this actin would keep moving in to this, and that is why it is known as sliding filament theory. Two scientists who explain this process, but the biochemistry behind it of muscle contraction was given by Albert Zend Georgi. So the complete mechanism, the complete biochemistry of this contraction was given by Albert Zend Georgi. But the theory, which is known as muscle sliding filament theory, was given by Huxley and Huxley. So we need to understand the structure, and if we understand the structure, then the mechanism of contraction becomes easier. The next question which I have has been asked by Sushant Singh from Chandigarh. And the question is, during diastole in the heart gets filled with which type of blood? Now, when we are using the word diastole, we are talking about a condition when the heart is relaxed. So, if you have watched the video on cardiac cycle, in cardiac cycle we have discussed that a stage is there when the two auricles are contracted and then two auricles relax, that is auricular diastole, and then a stage comes when the ventricles also relax and two auricles are also relaxing. So we call that stage as joint diastole. So if we talk of, say, let me just quickly draw a simple diagram so that we are able to understand which type of blood would come into these compartments when the heart is relaxed. So in case of auricles, here are the openings of the pulmonary veins. Here is an opening of superior vena cava, inferior vena cava. So if we are talking about a condition that is auricular diastole, that means auricles are relaxed. When we were talking about this in the chapter in detail, we discussed that there are certain valves in the blood vessels. That is, inferior vena cava has a valve, coronary sinus here also has a valve, and these openings also have valves. They do not have valves, these pulmonary and superior. When auricles relax, that means all these vessels are open, their openings are open, and the blood keeps coming into the auricle because auricles are now relaxed. This is the left atrium, this is left ventricle, right auricle, right ventricle. These are the openings of pulmonary veins. This is superior vena cava and this is inferior. So all the valves, that is of inferior and coronary sinus, are open. The blood keeps coming into the auricles. This is when auricles are relaxed. This compartment receives oxygenated blood from the lungs. So the left atrium is receiving oxygenated blood, and the right atrium is receiving deoxygenated blood. That means both types of bloods are coming into the auricles. Now, when ventricles contract, they have pumped the blood into the respective arteries, and now when the ventricles are in diastole, that means they relax. During contraction, the blood has been pumped. When they are relaxed, now their volume has increased. So from here, the blood keeps coming into the respective ventricle. So left ventricle during ventricular diastole is going to receive the oxygenated blood from the auricle. So this is going to receive oxygenated blood, and the right ventricle is going to receive deoxygenated blood. So auricles receive according to the blood vessels which open into them. Here pulmonary veins open, which bring oxygenated blood. Here vena cavas open, which bring deoxygenated blood. So depending upon which compartment we are talking of and which diastole are we talking about, this is auricular diastole And when we are talking of joint diastole, that is the time when auricles are also relaxed and ventricles are also relaxed. So all four compartments are relaxed. So one part or one half of the heart always receives oxygenated blood and the other half always receives deoxygenated blood. In case of human beings or even in birds, where there are four-chambered heart, there is no mixing of blood which is seen. So there is no situation where we have mixed blood in case of human heart. The next question which I have now has been asked by Animesh Dash from Odisha. And the question is, what is the photorespiration rate occurring in C3 plants at low light and high light intensities and at high and low carbon dioxide concentration? Let us first talk about what exactly is this photorespiration. Photorespiration is a process which occurs whenever the enzyme Rubisco, which is normally acting as carboxylase, starts to behave like oxygenase. Normally, if it acts as carboxylase, then it is going to favor photosynthetic process or C3 cycle. That is, how does this work? RuBP is going to bind with carbon dioxide, and this is where the enzyme is working. So it helps in addition or binding of carbon, basically. So it is known as carboxylase. It acts as carboxylase. But under certain conditions, it acts as oxygenase. And when it acts as oxygenase, it actually changes this reaction. In this reaction, RuBP, instead of binding with carbon dioxide, binds with oxygen. Again, the enzyme is same, but here it is acting as oxygenase. In normal condition, it favors binding of RuBP with carbon dioxide. Under certain conditions, its behavior changes. From carboxylase, it behaves like oxygenase. What are those conditions? The conditions when this behavior is seen. Number one, temperature is high. And two, carbon dioxide concentration is low. And oxygen concentration is more. In these conditions, the behavior of enzyme is going to be like oxygenase. So now, in these two conditions which have been asked in the question, how is photorespiration going to get affected? First, and we are talking of C3 plants. In C3 plants, this problem of photorespiration takes place because they do not have any adaptations to overcome these situations. Whereas C4 plants have undergone adaptations, like they have Krenz anatomy, dimorphic chloroplast, the site of C3 cycle has been shifted from mesophyll to bundle sheath. So because of that, they don't undergo this problem of photorespiration. In plants, in C3 plants, the two situations, one is carbon dioxide high and low. So if carbon dioxide is low, and when would this state or situation be seen and oxygen is more? This situation would arise when stomata are closed and light reaction takes place. When light reaction is taking place, there is photolysis of water. And in light reaction, due to photolysis, oxygen is given out. And that is why concentration of oxygen is going to be more. And comparatively, because as light reaction is taking place, dark can automatically take place. So whatever carbon dioxide is there inside will be used up for C3 cycle. So concentration of CO2 will go on decreasing. Concentration of oxygen will increase. So here, photorespiration increases. So where carbon dioxide concentration is low and oxygen concentration is more, rate of photorespiration is going to increase. The second situation, reverse of it, if carbon dioxide is more, then oxygen would be less comparatively. In this case, it is going to work as carboxylase. So here, photorespiration is negligible. So here, it's not going to matter much. But in this condition, there would be problem of photorespiration. The second factor is light, which has been asked in the question. As we can see here, light is not having a direct effect. So the second situation or factor is light intensity. At high light intensity, photorespiration will take place, but that is going to be very, very less. So, is very less. So, light as such does not affect photorespiration unless and until the light intensity is too high. Again, when light intensity would be too high, that is an adverse condition for the plant and stomata will close. And if due to very high light intensity, stomatal closure takes place, then the situation is going to be like this. So that is going to be an indirect effect. Directly, high light intensity does not result into photorespiration that much. This question has been asked by Manish Khanna from Punjab. The question is actually, like, what are the tricks to remember cycles like electron transport chain, Krebs cycle, Kelvin cycle? This is what is the question. If you have seen the videos which I have uploaded in the chapter of cellular respiration, I have given certain tricks to remember these cycles. So it would be beneficial if you could just go through those cycles. You would understand the cycles as well as the tricks to remember those. The next question has been asked by Nirmal Mishra from Ghaziabad. And the question is about respiratory system. And the question says, expiratory muscles contract at what time? Basically, when we are talking of respiration, here the question is related to breathing mechanism. Breathing mechanism. Breathing is completed in two parts. One is inhalation or inspiration. Or inhalation, that is when we take the air in. This process is active. So during this process, energy is required. So this is an active process. And there are two main types of muscles which are involved. They are called external intercostal muscles. And the second are diaphragm muscles, which are also known as phrenic muscles. So here the contraction is taking place, active process, that is inhalation. Now expiration or exhalation, the second part, expiration or exhalation is a passive process. And whenever there is a passive thing, that means no energy is used up. So when we are breathing in, these muscles contract, because of which the volume of the thoracic cavity increases, pressure decreases, and the air rushes in. But we call it active because there's contraction of muscles taking place. During exhalation or expiration, there is no contraction. On the contrary, these muscles, they relax. When they relax, the thoracic cavity's volume decreases, pressure increases, and the air from the lungs, that is from higher pressure, is thrown out to the atmosphere, that is low pressure. The muscles which are used during expiration, that is only during forceful expiration. So, during forceful exhalation, forceful exhalation, which is again an active process. That means here, if we want to forcefully exhale some more air after normal exhalation, we breathe in, 500 milliliters of air goes in, and when we exhale, that same 500 milliliters, which we call the tidal volume, is exhaled. After exhaling that normal volume, if we want to forcefully exhale some more air, then that process is known as forceful exhalation, which is active. Here, again, there are two types of muscles which are involved. One are known as abdominal muscles, which actually pull the abdominal organs up closer to the diaphragm. And the second category of muscles are known as intercostal muscles. Internal intercostal muscles are again present between the ribs, and they would pull the thoracic cavity even inwards. So the pressure inside, volume will decrease, pressure will increase even more, and the air from again higher pressure, that is from the lungs, will be thrown out. So the muscles are required only during forceful exhalation. During normal exhalation, there is no contraction of muscle. The muscles which contract during inhalation, they relax at this time. So it is a passive process. Forceful exhalation requires muscles. When these muscles contract, that is when we exhale some more air. And this is an active process. This is the last question which I'm taking for the first video of our Q&A series. This question has been asked by Kali Prasad Rai from Noida. And the question is, why whales, cartilaginous fishes, excrete urea as they have abundant water available? They should excrete ammonia, conversion of ammonia into urea is energy consuming. So why are they wasting this energy? So the question is basically because when we were talking about ammonotelism, ureotelism and uricotelism, the main reason for this nitrogenous waste to be eliminated is there are a couple of factors. One important factor was availability of water. And we said that if plenty of water is available, they would be able to excrete ammonia itself because it is toxic and it should be eliminated. Now, whales, cartilaginous fishes, which are aquatic animals, why can't they eliminate ammonia? And to convert that ammonia into urea, energy is required. So this question is very logical in the sense that if they have plenty of water, why are they still wasting that energy for converting ammonia into urea? If they're doing it, there has to be a reason for it. And the reason is, these organisms, that is whales and cartilaginous fishes, they are marine. Whale and the water or the medium in which they have to live is more concentrated. So they need to retain some kind of solute so that they are able to maintain the hypertonic body fluid. So they retain urea to maintain hypertonic nature, hypertonic nature of their body fluid. If they have to maintain the osmolarity of their body, they would need some kind of solute. And that is why they retain this urea in the body. And if urea is to be synthesized, then only it can be retained in the body. And if it can be retained, then that is the main nitrogenous material which is going to be excreted out. So though they have plenty of water available, but there is another very important aspect which they have to deal with. And that is the surrounding in which they are living. And the surrounding is more concentrated because marine water is salty. It has more salt content. So if they have to maintain this hypertonic nature of the body fluid, they will have to retain some solute in their blood, and that solute becomes urea, and so they are ureotelic. So they are ureotelic. Instead of ammonotelic. So had it been only the water constraint, they would have released ammonia, but because they have to take care of their surrounding also, that is why by spending energy, they have converted that ammonia into urea so that it can be retained to maintain this hypertonic nature. So with this, we have come to the end of our first video of our Q&A series. If you have questions which have not been answered, you can repost those questions in the comment box of this video. There are students who are posting their comments on different videos of different chapters. If you want me to take up those questions and answer them in our Q&A series, it would be better if you could post those questions on this video, because that is going to be easier for us to compile them and answer. So you start posting your questions on this video. Till Friday, we will collect the questions which are posted till Friday. I am going to compile them, and the next video, that is video number 2 of Q&A series, would be posted on next Monday, that is 27th of this month.